Technology. It shapes and reshapes our world. The hardware and the software make us aware of better ways of doing things. For work or for leisure, technology can improve our lives
and re-energize our lifestyles.
We can create it
or we can adapt it.
The technology of the present can help us prepare
for a future perfect.
Hi, I'm Tony Velasquez. Environmental consciousness has gone beyond simple recycling and choosing energy-efficient appliances. The growing trend these days is to go clean and green from your food to your car to your home. Going green has already evolved in such a way that ecological practices are now observed long before the first hole is dug and the first brick is laid.
Construction is one of the most energy-intensive industries in the world. While this may not be so obvious since bulldozers, haulers, and welders don't seem to use that much energy compared to the millions of vehicles that crisscross EDSA each day, the materials that typically go into buildings do require a lot of energy to make. Cement, the most common material used in construction, is made by heating limestone to more than 2,600 degrees Fahrenheit. Producing 1 ton of cement produces roughly a ton of carbon dioxide emissions from the burning of fossil fuels. The U.S. Environmental Protection Agency lists cement production as the third largest source of greenhouse gas pollution in the United States. Steel, another major ingredient in any construction project, meanwhile, consumes around 8 to 10% of all U.S. manufacturing energy use. After the construction phase is finished, the maintenance costs kick in. Roughly 40% of the world's energy gets used for lighting, air conditioning, heating, and other electrical consumption of buildings. The maintenance of buildings is responsible for 30% of the world's carbon emissions. As the world becomes more and more concerned about climate change, many are asking if there's a better way to build and maintain structures which would minimize their impact on the environment. Can technology help us construct buildings that are friendlier to the planet?
And joining us on Future Perfect is architect Cruz de la Cruz, the chair of the Philippine Green Building Council, and Raymond Rufino, the executive vice president of the Net Group, which has commissioned the first Berde certified building in the Philippines. Raymond and Cruz, thank you for coming to the show.
Thank you, Tony.
Yeah, see, we've actually prepared Berde chairs for you to sit down.
Yes.
So that you feel right at home.
We've noticed.
That's all very right. Good.
Berde, how old has this concept been?
Well, the discussion for the development of our own rating scheme started in 2007. It took us a good 3 years to have it launched. We had it launched in November, and now we're finally coming up with our first Berde certified building.
What does it mean to be Berde certified?
Well, Berde means building for ecologically responsive design excellence. It's a rating tool and a guidance tool that allows designers and developers come up with informed choices in designing and constructing buildings.
Yeah.
You have to look at water efficiency, energy efficiency, the materials you're using, and a lot more parameters, because we're trying to come up with a more holistic approach in developing our structures here in the Philippines.
Okay. Are there any restrictions or things that you avoid when you certify a building as having complied with Berde standards?
Well, the only restriction that we have is we would like to ensure that each and every building complies with our national environmental standards here in the Philippines.
Okay.
In fact, the focus of Berde is to ensure that our businessmen, as they come up with new building stock, that they are complying these standards, and we're going to start measuring how much above and beyond standards and legislation here in the Philippines these buildings are performing.
Mm-hmm. So the Berde standard isn't really over and above what the national standard is?
In fact, that's what it does. It pushes the market to perform over and above business as usual scenario. With standards and regulations, the discussion is always playing at the mandatory minimum. With Berde, the idea is to create a little bit of peer pressure in industry, pushing the other guy towards excellence. And we're going to start rating the buildings by the number of stars. And you know how the scenario will be. If in the block there is a two-star building, the next guy who comes up with the building would like to have three. And that's how we would like to push. Hopefully we get to see in the very near future a five-star rated building.
But I wonder now whether or not Raymond is actually aiming for five stars right away. With your building. The building
actually
is called
Net Lima.
Net Lima.
Actually, Net Lima is the pilot project for Berde. And so it was the first project. We did an interface with the Philippine Green Building Council and said we want to participate in the development of the rating tool. So what we did was we basically did this partnership and we provided user testing for the certification system. And we will be actually the first fully certified building. We just are finalizing the arrangements now to undergo the entire process. So to be quite honest, we don't know even ourselves how many stars we're going to get, because when we designed the building, we did, you know, we designed it much earlier on, and so we put in a lot of features that we felt were green and we wanted to focus on. We will see when the certification is done how many stars we actually get as part of the process.
Well, what goes into a Berde certified building like Net Lima?
There's a lot of things. I would like to talk about our facade.
Okay.
What makes Net Lima quite different from other buildings is we have a special design for the curtain wall. So you have a double pane of glass, you have an argon gas in between, and then you have a special coating on one of the layers of glass which rejects heat.
Argon glass in between the double
argon
pane?
Argon gas, yes. And then you have a low E coating on one of the panes. So that's your glass, you know, sort of facade of the building. Then we have a sunshade made of aluminum that wraps around the entire building.
Is argon gas like a refrigerant?
No, it's not a refrigerant. It actually controls the amount of heat that comes in. The idea being, you get your clear glass view, but the amount of heat that comes into your office space is much reduced. So that combination of the glass and the sunshade really reduces the solar heat
that
comes in.
So the argon acts as sort of like to control the air temperature,
the heat,
as it passes through.
The heat of the sunlight coming in, yes.
Wow.
So that's a very, very unique feature. Not a lot. This is the first time you're going to have it in the Philippines.
Who
that
developed
kind of technology.
That concept?
We had an international architect called Chad Oppenheim who came up with the concept. Then we worked with our engineers and our local consultants to kind of develop how this would be implemented in terms of actual construction.
He developed it originally for Net Lima, or are other buildings using the same
concept? A lot of buildings abroad have used this sort of similar technology, but this will be the first time it's being done here in the Philippines.
Right, right. So you're talking about the facade itself. Now,
yes.
Going past the facade and in the interior.
Yes, we have a lot of green features as well as on the interior. So, for example, our air conditioning, we use the an air-cooled system which produces a lot of condensate water. Normally, that's thrown away. It goes into the sewer and you never use it. We're collecting all of that condensate water and reusing it in the building, in the
laboratories
and other things, yes. So that's going to reduce the amount of water we're actually going to consume. Other things, for example, we have our fuel tanks. Normally, most developers, if they're doing an office building, have to provide fuel as backup for their gensets. The fuel tanks used to be steel. The problem with steel is they rust, they leak, they last for only 10 to 15 years, then you have to replace. We're using now fiberglass tanks, which are much better because they last 30 years.
Okay.
You can repair them. They have automatic leak detection so that your fuel, if it leaks, does not go into the soil or the environment. You can actually detect that there's a leak and go in and fix the problem. So that's another nice feature. We also have this interesting feature where some of the waste air conditioning from the building, we're actually channeling to the area right in front of our lobby.
You mean the cooled air?
Because normally in a building, you exhaust a bit of your cool air.
Okay.
That's part of the air exchange process. What we've done is we've channeled some of that to right in front of our lobby. So when you step out of the lobby, you'll feel like a cool breeze.
So it's actually, there's like an air curtain.
Sort of, because normally that air is just thrown away. Here we've provided a comfort area where the air can actually be used productively rather than just throwing it away to the atmosphere.
Oh, terrific, yeah. Terrific.
Yeah, so those are some of the things we've done.
You know, Raymond, a lot of people are thinking that when you go into these green features, that your construction costs or design costs necessarily go up because there are some economies of scale, I guess, that have to be factored into this. Now, did the developers, did the builders actually think that, you know, never mind the cost, but let's go ahead with the green features, or did you manage to save costs?
Our strategy really was not about, you know, are we going to go green? How much is that? Let's see how much it's going to cost. We really said we want to develop a certain kind of building. Okay. It's a premium green building. So
the cost was a secondary consideration.
Yes. For us, we really wanted to do an iconic sort of landmark building. For us, it was about making a statement about we as developers, about Fort Bonifacio as a new central business district. We really wanted to do a project that would stand out from the rest. So what we did was we established our goals, and then we worked our costing from there. Now, we did not categorize things as sort of green features because, for example, our facade, that is both a architecture.